Welcome in my YouTube channel. In this video, we are going to learn the definition and some examples of Stelzel's transform and three important theorems, we can say. The first is elementary properties of Stelzel's transform. The second one is how it is related to the Laplace transform. And third one is its inversion formula. So all these things we will going to learn in this video. So let us start this video. First of all, we define the Stelzel's transform like this. Suppose fx is some function, then its Stelzel's transform denoted by s of fx semicolon y and is equals to integration from 0 to infinity fx upon x plus y dx. Obviously this integral will be with respect to x and y is constant there, so the output will be some function of y, and let us denote this function as f tilde y. So the Stelzel's transform of fx is generally denoted by f tilde y. Consider this example. Suppose fx equals to x plus a raised to the power minus 1, and let us find out its Stelzel's transform. Then by definition it will be integration 0 to infinity fx by x plus y dx. Let us put fx equals to x plus a inverse. We have this integral, and after using partial fraction we can write this integral like this: 1 by a minus y integration 0 to infinity 1 by x plus y minus 1 by x plus a dx, and after integrating it we have this result, and on putting the limits we get this result. So its Stelzel's transform is 1 by a minus y log a by y. Next, we are going to learn some elementary properties of Stelzel's transform. So this is the first property, and it tell us that if Stelzel's transform of fx is at f tilde y, then Stelzel's transform of x into fx is given by this expression: integration 0 to infinity fx dx minus y into f tilde y. Let us prove it. We know the Stelzel's transform of fx is denoted by f tilde y, and it is defined by this integral. So the Stelzel's transform of x into fx will be given by this integral: x fx by x plus y dx, and this integral can be written like this: in place of x we can write x plus y minus y, and let us separate this integral into two integrals. We have these two integrals. The first is integration 0 to infinity x plus y by x plus y fx dx minus y, since y is constant, so take it out from the integral sign, into integration 0 to infinity fx x plus y dy, and here it will be cancelled out. So the first term will become simply integration 0 to infinity fx dx, and this integral is nothing but f tilde y. So we can write it y into f tilde y, and this proves this property. Now let us come into the second property. In this property we have to show if f tilde y is Stelzel's transform of fx, then Stelzel's transform of fx upon x plus a is given by 1 upon a minus y f tilde y minus f tilde a. We know the Stelzel's transform is defined like this, and therefore established transform of fx by x plus a is given by this integral. We just write fx by x plus a in place of fx, and after using partial fraction, this integral can be written like this. And after that, we separate these two term in different integral, so we can write this integral as 1 by a minus y integration fx x plus y dx minus integration 0 to infinity fx by x plus a dx, and this integral is nothing but f tilde y, since it is Stelzner's transform of fx, and the second one is also Stelzner's transform of fx, but in place of a we have a, so we can write it f tilde a, and this proves this property. This is the third one. It tells us that if f tilde y is Stelzner's transform of fx, then Stelzner's transform of f of ax will be given by f tilde ay. Since we have this definition of Stelzner's transform of fx, and therefore Stelzner's transform of f of ax is given by this integral, let us put ax equals to u in this integral, then this integral will take the form of this integral, and after simplification we can write this integral like this, and this is nothing but f tilde ay, since this is the integral in which we have to integrate with respect to u, and it is a different integral, and therefore this integral is Stelzner's transform of fx, but in place of y we have ay, so it is f tilde ay, and this proves property number 3. This is the fourth property. In this property it is given that if f tilde y is Stelzner's transform of fx, then Stelzner's transform of x inverse into f x inverse will be y inverse into f tilde y inverse. We have this definition, and therefore Stelzner's transform of x inverse f x inverse is given by this integral, and we just substitute x inverse by u, we get this integral. Now after simplification, this integral will become like this, and if you take y in common from the denominator, the integral take this form, and this integral is nothing but f tilde y inverse, since in place of y we have y inverse, so this is 1 upon y, or we can say y inverse f tilde y inverse, and this proves property number 4. Similarly, property number 5 can be easily put, and it is given like this, so it is your task to prove this result. Now come into the property number 6. In this property, the Stelzner's transform of f under root x is given by f tilde iota under root y plus f tilde minus iota under root y, where f tilde y is Stelzner's transform of fx. We know the definition of Stelzner's transform like this, and therefore Stelzner's transform of f of root x is given by this integral. Let us put root x equals to u, or x equals to u square. We have this integral in place of this integral. We have u square minus y in the denominator, and this u square minus y can be written like this: u square minus iota under root y whole square, and it is of the form a square minus b square, so we can break it like a plus b into a minus b, and after that we use partial fraction, and we can write this integral into the sum of two integrals like this: 0 to infinity f u plus iota y plus integration 0 to infinity f u du by u minus iota y. And the first integral is nothing but f tilde iota y, and the second integral, this integral, is nothing but f tilde minus iota y. So this proves this property. Now this is the property number 7. In this property we have to show that Stelzer's transform of derivative of fx is given by minus f0 by y minus del by del y of f tilde y, where f tilde y is Stelzer's transform of fx. We know the definition of Stelzer's transform like this, and therefore Stelzer's transform of derivative of fx, that is f dash x, is given by this integral. Now let us integrate it using by part. So f dash x is our second function, and 1 upon x plus y will be the first function. Then by using by part, we have these two terms. First one is fx by x plus y, limit from 0 to infinity, plus integration 0 to infinity fx by x plus y whole square, and the first term will become minus f0 by y on putting the limits, and the second term is nothing but minus del f tilde y by del y. You can see easily obtain this expression from here by differentiating partially both sides with respect to y. So this proves property number 7. Now let us see how Stelzer's transform is related with the Laplace transform. We know the Laplace transform of a function fx is defined by this integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus px fx dx, and it is denoted by f of p. Let us take Laplace transform of fx, and by definition it will be e to the power py fp dp. After that let us write the value of fp is there. So after putting the value of fp, which is given by this integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus px fx dx, we get this double integral. And let us interchange the order of integration, we get this integral. And in this integral we have to integrate with respect to p first. So after integrating we have this result: integration 0 to infinity fx, this is the integration of this function with respect to p. So it is e to the power minus p x plus y by x plus y, and limits are infinity to 0 since minus is there. And now after putting this limit we get this expression as 1 by x plus y. So this integral will become simply 0 to infinity fx by x plus y dx, and this is f tilde y. So what we see is that Laplace transform of x is the Stelzer's transform of fx, that is f tilde y, or we can say the double Laplace transform of fx is Stelzer's transform of fx, and it is generated by f tilde y. So we can write L square equals to s, means double Laplace transform of a function is equals to the Stelzer's transform of the same function. And this is actually relation between the Laplace transform and Stelzer's transform. Now we are going to learn inversion formula of Stelzer's transform. So consider a function gz which is analytic in the complex plane, cut along the negative real axis and satisfy this gross condition, limit mod z tending to infinity e to the power pz gz equals to 0 for real part of z less than equals to alpha. Gz is analytic within and on the closed contour C given in this figure. Look, this is the figure. This is the closed contour C which is cut along the negative real axis, and we have this point. This point is actually x equals to alpha, and the interior region is obviously, in the interior region we must have real part of z less than equals to alpha. By Cauchy theorem, this line integral e to the power pz gz over c, c is this closed contour given in this figure, is equals to 0, and this line integral over c e to the power pz gz can be written like this: integration from a to b, integration from this point to this point. This is the first integral. Second one is from b to e. So from b to e is like this, from b to e, from this point, okay, e to h. So this is from here to here. After that, over the circular region j. So our j is this, this circular region. After that, k to l. So k to l. After that, l to a. So from l to a. And in this way, this is the complete contour C. And this integration, this line integration can be written like this. Okay. Now, by Cauchy theorem, sum of these integrals of this function e to the power pz gz equals to 0, and this is the C in which the points a, b, d, e, h, k, l, n, a all are given. This implies that the point a, we know this is the point x equals to alpha, and suppose this length is t, this length is also t. So from a to b, which is from alpha minus iota t to alpha plus iota t e to the power pz gz dz. So dz is there also, dz should be there, dz, dz. And after that, this bracket include three integrals, these three integrals, this one, and this one. Okay, and remaining two integrals inside the green circle. So these two integrals can be written like this: t to epsilon e to the power minus px g of x e to the power iota pi dx plus dx should be there. And the second integral is from epsilon to t e to the power minus px g of x e to the power iota pi into dx equals to 0. So this is the integral e to h, where epsilon is the radius of this small circle, and the capital T is obviously this one. This is capital T, not R, this is capital T. Now J is given by mod J equals to epsilon, and we have this growth condition in the real part of Z less than equals to alpha. So this implies that the limiting value of this integral at mod Z tending to 0 will be 0, and the limiting value of this integral is also 0. And as epsilon tending to 0, this integral e to the power pz gz over j will be 0. So these three integrals actually will become 0. These two are due to the growth condition, and this one as epsilon tending to 0. So we have as t tending to infinity and epsilon tending to 0, the integration from alpha minus iota infinity to alpha plus iota infinity e to the power pz gz plus this integral dx is there, dz is here, dx should be there, dx should be there. So this result, so from this result we can write the first integral like this, and let us multiply 1 by twice pi iota and twice pi iota. So it will balance the value, and let us transform these two integrals in the right side. So we have this relation, and from the complex inversion formula of Laplace transform, this integral actually, this integral is Laplace inverse of gz. So in the left hand side we have twice pi iota L inverse of gz, and in the right side the first integral is Laplace transform of this function x e to the power minus iota pi, and second one is Laplace transform of this function, means Laplace transform of g of x e to the power iota pi. And this result implies just that L2 inverse gz is equals to twice pi iota inverse gx e to the power minus iota pi minus gx e to the power iota pi. And we know L square equals to S, means double Laplace transform is equals to SLS transform. So in the left side we have SLS inverse of gz is given by this expression. So this gives the inversion formula of SLS transform. Okay, thank you.